today, if you ask somebody what kind of mouse they need, they'll probably be thinking they need to pick between USB or Bluetooth. But 30 years ago, there were quite a few other standards, including Microsoft Bus Mouse, IBM PS2, Sun Microsystems, Apple ADB, and Tandy. And at least all of these guys used different connectors along with different protocols. But then you also had Serial, Commodore, Amiga, Atari, and the older Macintosh standards, which all used the same 9-pin connector but were entirely incompatible, electrically speaking. But it isn't so much the interface that I want to talk about today, but rather the mechanics of how a mouse interprets motion. The original mouse design back in the 1960s was a block of wood, and it had two perpendicular wheels on the bottom to register motion in both directions. Of course, this meant that no matter which direction you were moving the mouse, it was dragging one of those wheels sideways, which meant movement probably wasn't super smooth. Moving forward into the early 80s, I want to show you another design. This Tandy mouse uses a stainless steel ball. Let's open it up so we can see how it works. Here's the ball. It's designed to be heavy so that it makes good friction with the surface. Now you can see it uses two rollers on the ball for X and Y motion. Now these rollers are connected to potentiometers, and much like a potentiometer on a volume knob, they actually have a limited range of motion. To better illustrate what I'm talking about, I'm going to draw some lines on the roller here. Now this is just to help you see the motion, especially for those watching on a small screen. So hopefully you can see the movement of the roller really well now. So if you look closely, you can see that as I move the mouse, at some point the roller will stop moving. And you might just think there isn't enough friction to make it move, but I'll actually remove the ball here and show you I physically cannot move the roller anymore in this direction. So using this sort of mouse could be a pain. I mean, imagine drawing a box around your mouse and saying that you can never move the mouse outside of this box, and you can never pick the mouse up and move it either. So yeah, that's a pretty annoying design. So let's have a look at the next step in evolution. This mouse uses what appears to be a rubber ball, but it's actually a steel ball coated in rubber, so it has the weight required, but the surface has more friction. And again, we have rollers, but this time there are no potentiometers. Instead, there are these little wheels, and on each side of the wheel, you may notice there are sensors. These are actually optical sensors. They aren't cameras as such, they either detect the presence or absence of light. So as the wheel spins, these two sensors receive input about the movement, and they can even tell the direction of the movement depending upon the order of the flashes of light. Later on, this design was cost reduced in most mice, and instead there was what appears to be a single sensor. But all they've done is moved both sensors to the same device. So as you can see, it still works on the same principle. But what does the mouse actually see? Well, if you think of it as having 4 pixels, downward motion would look like pulses of light like this. And upward motion would look like this. Move to the right and you see this. So you get the idea. So this sort of mouse is actually called an optomechanical mouse because it incorporates optics and it's also mechanical. Of course, one big problem with these types of mice is the rollers get gummed up with crud over time and then they don't work smoothly anymore or sometimes just don't work at all. The average person seemed to have no idea how to properly clean the mouse. Most people thought the ball was what got dirty, so they'd try to clean the ball, but that never seemed to make it work better. The real problem was the rollers. Crud would build up on these and need to be mechanically scraped off the rollers in order to get the mouse working smoothly again. And that's where the benefit of an optical mouse comes in. So let's have a look at one of the first optical mice, actually two of them. These are the same mouse being sold for PCs and for Sun workstations. In fact, turn them around and you'll see both are manufactured by Mouse Systems. The main difference, of course, is the interface style at the end of the cable, but we're not really interested in that for the moment. The interesting thing about these optical mice is that they require a special mouse pad. It's a bit hard to see, but the pad is a grid. In fact, through the help of a magnifier, hopefully you can see a bit better. Actually, the pad's meant for a later Sun mouse like this one, and thus is incompatible with the mouse I'm actually showing, but these pads are really hard to find as it is, and the older ones are practically impossible to find, but the main point was just to show that it needed a special pad. Now, if we turn it upside down, you'll notice that there are two lenses, but only one of them is lit up. You might be tempted to think that one of the LEDs is burned out, or maybe it only uses one of the holes. But let's take a look with a Game Boy camera. Mostly I just wanted a quick way to look for infrared light, and sure enough, you can see there's plenty of light coming out of the left side as well. So how does this work? Well, the pad is designed with reflective lines, like this. However, one set of lines is only reflective to infrared light, and the other set of lines is reflective to red light. So depending upon which light source is used, only horizontal or vertical lines will appear, and so that's the magic here. Let's take a look inside the mouse. Now, what we're looking at here is a red LED and an infrared LED. Now, these are both facing downwards to the pad. There are two identical lenses here. I know one looks red, and that's because we see the light from the red LED. and then you'll find a horizontal sensor and a vertical sensor. And notice they're designed to pick up light in the form of a line, and they are turned perpendicular to each other. But how does the light reach the sensors? Well, if you look at the inside cover of the mouse, you'll find two mirrors, and these reflect the light down under the sensor. And to some extent, if you look down at the lenses while I move the mouse on the pad, you can actually see the lines. Now, if I had the correct pad for this mouse, the lines would be even more visible. Anyway, the point is, believe it or not, this mouse sees more or less the exact same thing that the optomechanical mouse sees. So now let's move on to a more modern style optical mouse. These do essentially have a camera in them that looks at the surface, but what I wanted to see is if it would be possible to hack into the camera and see exactly what it sees. And so here we go. So what are we looking at here? This is the sensor, and we'll talk more about this in a moment. Here's the LED that lights up the surface, and this is a microcontroller. Its job is to read the movement information from the sensor, also read the status of the buttons and scroll wheel, and then translate that into a PS2 compatible data stream. For the purposes of this hack, it was really important to find an older mouse with these two items being separate. In newer mice, they have combined these things into a single chip to reduce cost. So in a newer mouse, the buttons would connect straight to this chip, as would the PC interface. Well, with the separator design, it makes it possible for me to talk directly to the sensor. First, I'll need to see if I can find the chip number. This is one of those chips where you have to look at just the right angle to see anything. And with the help of a magnifying glass, I was able to read it, and fortunately was also able to find a data sheet. This is a must, as it explains exactly how the timing of the serial protocol works, as well as what registers can be read and written to. At this point, the plan is simply to remove the microcontroller, and the easiest way for me to do that is just to cut the legs off and then desolder them one by one. Then I used a multimeter to figure out which wires went to the PS2 connector and which ones went to the microcontroller. And I made myself a little diagram on a piece of paper. The idea is I can keep the existing wire here for the power, ground, and two of the serial lines. Unfortunately, I realized later that this serial connection requires three wires, so I had to run a separate wire for that. Anyway, for the moment, I just added some jumper wires to connect the serial port of the sensor straight up to the old PS2 wires. I decided to use the Color Maximite 2 for this project since it was still handy for my recent project. It took me a few hours to get the code up and working, but the idea here is I'd be able to display the camera image right on the screen. Much easier to do here than with an Arduino. The most basic test was to get to the point I could read and write to registers. So in this case, I'll write to register 58 and a value of 90, which means to reset the sensor. My program actually shows on screen the binary data transmitted one bit at a time over the serial line, which helped me in troubleshooting. The next thing I can do is read a register, such as register 0. This register returns the version number of the sensor, which according to the datasheet should always be a value of 12 hex, which is 18 in decimal. So I've mastered reading and writing to the sensor. Now you'd think all I need to do now is read register B here, which is pixel grab. There are only 224 pixels, so don't expect a super high resolution image. I also have to read these pixels one at a time by requesting a specific pixel to read. And here we go. I have good news and bad news. The good news is, it does work. The bad news is, I could only ever read the first pixel correctly until I introduced a 50 millisecond delay between reads. I'm not sure why this was necessary, but it does mean that it takes a while to grab the entire sensor. I was hoping to be able to show fluid motion. Anyway, so you might wonder, what is it we're looking at here? Well, it's that Sun grid style mouse pad. Unfortunately, the sensor is fixed on a very tiny area, almost microscopic, so I had a hard time finding anything to show you that could actually recognize. But anyway, it does work, and if I move the mouse just a hair, you'll see the image redraw just a bit as well. And so that about wraps it up for this episode, but if you stick around to the next one, I'm going to be showing off this little mini pet, which I'm really excited about. So hope you stick around for that, and of course, thanks for watching.